Welcome everyone to this important panel entitled Advancing Justice, Responses to Anti-Asian Racism in the U.S. This is sponsored by the Harvard University Asia Center and also co-sponsored by the Committee on Ethnicity, Migration, Rights, and Rights, Fairbanks Center for Chinese Studies, the Harvard Yenching Institute, the Korea Institute, the Lakshmi Mittal and Family South Asia Institute, and the Program on U.S.-Japan Relations at the Weatherhead Center for International Affairs. So we thank everybody for their support today. So we're now over a year into the COVID pandemic, and while there has been hope on the horizon for dealing with the science of the virus with vaccines becoming more widely available, the social and cultural dimensions of the virus have become more and more troubling. The stereotyping and stigmatization that began last year grew as political rhetoric fanned the flames even further, and the incidents of anti-Asian racism that began to surface back then have become worse throughout the past year. And so we'd like to address those today in this panel as well. So I'll simply be introducing this afternoon's moderator, who will then introduce the panelists before they speak. And following the discussion, we will have a moderated Q&A period, and anybody who's attending today can type questions into the Zoom Q&A feature. So today's moderator is Dr. Vivian Shih. And Dr. Shih is a college fellow in the Department of Sociology at Harvard University and the lead researcher and co-PI for the AAPI COVID-19 project, which is a multi-method investigation into aspects of the pandemic and the lives of Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders, focusing largely on the intensification of racism and xenophobia faced by these groups. In May of last year, UNESCO launched a partnership with that project, and that continues. Dr. Shih earned her PhD in sociology from the University of Texas at Austin, and from 2018 to 2019, she was a postdoctoral fellow in the Weatherhead Center for International Relations program on U.S.-Japan relations, also at Harvard. And she's published widely on issues of anti-racism movements in Japan, including an article entitled Extreme Pressure, Gendered Negotiations of Violence and Vulnerability in Japanese Anti-Racism Movements, and is interested in the ways that disasters shape political contestations over the meanings of governance, citizenship, and social inclusion. So thank you very much for leading the discussion today, Dr. Shih, and I'll turn things over to you.
Thank you so much for having us today and for organizing this. So first, I just want to say thank you to James, Julie, Jorge, and Tenzin for putting this together and putting it together on quite short notice. James and I had been in conversation for, a couple of months thinking about how, I could come in and talk to staff in the Asia Center. And then in the wake of the massacre in Atlanta, we decided that perhaps a public forum would be really important. And, I appreciate the Asia Center and all other supporting centers for coming together to bring in these wonderful speakers. So before I introduce our panelists, and then I'll follow that with some very brief remarks, I wanted to acknowledge that although we are all joining in virtually, Harvard University and the Asia Center is situated on unceded Massachusetts land. So we're constantly learning from Indigenous populations, and we want you to pay respect and attention to Indigenous communities and acknowledge the long genocide and legacy of that. And we can talk more about that, if there's time in the Q&A. So I'm going to briefly introduce the speakers, and they will be speaking in this order. So today we're joined by three guest speakers who have a range of expertise in the areas of Asian American politics and Asian American organizing and public service. So the first speaker is Han Liu, who works at the National Employment Law Project. Han's work focuses on how inequalities of nationhood, carceral punishment, and the workplace shape one another. So prior to his work at NELP, Han was a line defender at the Orleans Public Defenders in New Orleans. He's a first-generation college graduate, and prior to law school, Han worked as a defense investigator for the Louisiana Center for Children's Rights, the juvenile public defender in his hometown of New Orleans. Christina Ong is a PhD student in sociology at the University of Pittsburgh, studying the development of Asian America in the 1960s through 1980s through an in-depth case study of New York City's Basement Workshop. She also serves as the Project Manager and Qualitative Committee co-lead for the AAPI COVID-19 project. We worked together on this, which is a multidisciplinary mixed method study on how COVID-19 is impacting Asian American, Asian and Pacific Islander lives in the US. So her research interests span topics related to diaspora, racial justice, and transnational feminisms. Elena Shih is the Manning Assistant Professor of American Studies and Ethnic Studies at Brown University, where she directs a human trafficking research cluster through Brown Center for the Study of Slavery and Justice. Shih's book project, Manufacturing Freedom, Trafficking, Rescue, Rehabilitation, and the Slave-Free Good, which is under contract with the University of California Press, is a global ethnography of the transnational social movement to combat human trafficking in China, Thailand, and the United States. And it's based on, you know, multiple years of ethnographic research. She is also an outreach organizer with Red Canary Song, a grassroots coalition of massage workers, sex workers, and allies in New York City. And I'm sure that many of you have heard about Red Canary Song in the recent weeks. So before we jump in with our presentations, and thank you also all of you for being here today, I just want to start, you know, returning to James's comments about how we are about over a year since the start of the pandemic and since you know, Harvard University evacuated its campus and then transitioned to, you know, classes and other types of academic operations online. And so I just remember last year when I sent out an email to students to try to negotiate what was going on, I had kind of given them a week to process things. And I sent out this email. And what I told them at that time was that we are not in normal times. And so we should not pretend that we are in normal times and proceed as normal, right? And why I said that was because clearly, you know, this pandemic had thrown us into upheaval, right? And so I felt that it wasn't fair or just to expect students to just proceed as normal, to pretend that what was happening all around them was not, and to that they were simply that they simply should just be students and focus only on their work, right? And you know, what was what you, this kind of idea of separating being a student from the reality of the pandemic and how it has impacted people in so many different ways was something I really wanted to question. But I kind of have been thinking about this concept of normal times, right? And while, you know, I think that it's a framework that I think is important for thinking about how do we show compassion towards each other, we can go like a little bit more critical and really think about what does that mean? How do those meetings shift for different people? And so we're clearly in a crisis right now, but crisis has a way of making things feel abnormal. And sometimes, you know, can create different types of opportunities, but also can invisibilize a lot of problems that had been existing all along, right? And so some of what we're gonna talk about today in these presentations is how these conditions that we are experiencing now as crisis, and particularly anti-Asian racism, are things that are not new, but rather are embedded deeply within the history of the US, the history of imperialism, and the history of racism in the US and more globally. And so this is something that we need to reconcile as we think about Asian American politics now and where we are going forward with that. So similarly, you know, oftentimes as people have been responding to this very conspicuous form of anti-Asian racism that we've observed, especially in the past month or so, but that we had have been witnessing since last spring, oftentimes people use the term increase, right? An increase in racism. And, you know, while I don't necessarily have all of the statistics for this in terms of, you know, in terms of how much more things have changed, right? We can definitely call this a process of racism becoming more visible, but I think to call it an increase is really overlooking how racism has been very pervasive and embedded within everyday social life, impacting communities within Asian America in very different ways. And so in environmental studies, we often use this concept of slow violence to talk about the way that racism and harms are, rather than simply being concentrated in specific extreme moments, are really rooted over time, right? And this kind of can affect people in terms of, say, their exposure to contamination, in terms of the neighborhoods that they live in, people engaged in really difficult work, right? That then have this sort of accrued impact on their lives. And so similarly, as we talk about anti-Asian violence today, I really want us to return to this idea and think deeply about how anti-Asian violence is not simply, an event that is a result of COVID, but rather something interwoven into our labor structure, our broader economy, and our infrastructure for dealing with citizenship and immigration. And so, especially when we talk about anti-Asian violence, we need to really be considerate towards socioeconomic issues, right? And so as we kind of discuss what happened in Atlanta, we will also think about how it's not simply Asian people or Asian women, but Asian women working in really precarious, vulnerable labor that is very public facing. And so ultimately what I hope today in these presentations is that we can think about the histories that have led us to this point and then where we are going from here. So with that said, let us welcome Han Liu to the floor. And Han, please take as much time to share your comments, and we're really excited for them. Thank you.
Thank you all for having me today. The Asia Center, Vivian, fellow panelists. I'm going to talk through several reflections, thinking through this prompt of advancing justice, and also the idea of responses to anti-Asian racism, particularly in the US. So my day-to-day work looks at the ways the criminal legal system degrades working conditions and worker power. And there's a couple of examples of this, right? So there's criminal records as a proxy for race. There's work as a condition of court sentencing. There's having an arrest warrant out for you when you can't pay a court-related debt. There's a lot of intersections there. And it's policy work in partnership with worker organizing, grassroots organizing. And a lot of my work winds up being about looking at narratives, like we call it narrative shift. The narratives we rely on to really tolerate a broad kind of radical inequality and extreme violence that policymakers take as Vivian says, the normal state of things. And really that's about trying to unravel those narratives. So that's things like how businesses and government justify who's deserving, who's not deserving, who belongs, who doesn't belong. When we think of things like who deserves access to pandemic recovery programs, who deserves stable employment, when we think of borders, who deserves status, what kind of status. And where I focus most is when we think of crime, who's culpable, who deserves to be punished, and probably most important in that context is who deserves to do the punishing. It's about what this story of individual meritocracy keeps us from being able to see. So that's like, really, we're talking about the American dream. And so individual meritocracy won't let us see how, for instance, why we're here today, how racialized war, dictatorships funded in the name of markets throughout the Pacific have shaped workplace segregation at home. And these are stories that run throughout. So it's both in existing systems, but also reform projects and proposed alternatives. And so even if we use these stories to meet goals, like strategic goals, like building broad alliances, we should really know who gets left out when we use them. And we should really ask whether we're making those decisions with intention. So I guess I'll take a step back right now and just say, I do this work grounded in my experience as an Asian person in this country. Racialized as an Asian person. I'm a Cold War migrant. I come from a family of both low-wage hotel workers and small business owners in Louisiana. As Vivian said, I'm a former public defender in New Orleans, and I've worked in both adult and children's defense offices. And as the most or one of the most incarcerated states in this country, Louisiana, and therefore the world, I don't take it for granted that, you know, for most of us, all of our lives, the violence of white supremacy and radical economic inequality hasn't been met by policymakers with like anti-racism and economic justice, but of course, instead has been met with decades of inflated, overfunded systems of punishment and surveillance and criminalization, and of course, all the violence those things entail. And so these systems expand and deepen the fundamental anti-Blackness and poverty. And to many of us, that's their functional intention, that's their purpose, to uphold the kinds of desperation that ensures there's depressed labor force. That it's not a mistake. But beyond all of that, so we don't have to always agree on that point. At the same time, what they do tell us, you know, simultaneously as they're doing that, is what they're doing is justice. And so in our title, we have this idea of justice too. And I think we know, or maybe we're coming to know a little better than that. So movements like the uprisings that spread from George Floyd's murder by police remind us and really remain our best source of collective wisdom and memory. Our most recent example of people refusing to witness the criminal legal system murder someone. But it took generations of organizing to get to this point of collective refusal. And really in my adult lifetime, it seemed as though, you know, I'm in my 30s now, most wouldn't believe the police's version unless there was some kind of video. And even then the conversations seemed to always be about particular bad, you know, anti-Black apples, not a system predicated on, you know, various forms of violence, ranging from the physicality of locking someone in a cell or police murder to the ritual humiliation that goes on every day in this country's criminal courts, where you walk into a bail hearing chained by the ankle and the waist to six other people, and a judge tells you how much it costs to get out. And down to the financial violence of the kind of debt you can't pay back and keeps you cycling in and out of county and parish jails. I'm gonna share my screen for a moment here. Let's see if this works. So could someone give me a thumbs up if they can see that? It's just a couple of bullets here. Thanks. So this is just the sort of 4 points I'm gonna try to move through quickly. And if part of this doesn't, you know, if we don't get to some of this, hopefully some of it I can bring up in Q&A. But I'll say here that, you know, these remarks really should be seen as invitations. This isn't a traditional kind of like policy talk. I wanna share them in this space because they've been useful to me personally, really, in understanding my own experience, but also in organizing spaces to understand my work. I wanna begin with grief. I think so many of us and all of our loved ones circles are really feeling this moment of grief. And in any moment of grief or trauma, one quality of that is that we stumble to even try to describe it. So in part, like that stumbling has to do with its truthfulness or its presence. So, you know, when we feel violated, whether it's like us personally from our own pain or witnessing the pain of others, it's really hard to connect in language the pieces and the events together. And that quality, that difficulty really tells us something both about, you know, its truthfulness, but also about the space it's taking up. So I just wanna give honor to that. I know all of us are having so many conversations in various circles, and that is so much energy and time and work, and we should recognize that. One big question that I think is coming up in a lot of circles that I share is, what will it take to really transform this moment of fear and grief into something else, into connectedness or courage or openness, solidarity. We're really being mobilized and called forth by a moment of fear. And in my position doing policy work, I am seeing advocates and politicians putting forward legislation to really ramp up criminal prosecution of violence on both local and federal levels. And we should acknowledge that that's happening at the same exact time as George Floyd's murder is on trial. And we should also see that it's not just the officer that's on trial. It's the systems that really normalized or enabled George Floyd's murder, our criminal system, that's really working hard to validate and legitimize itself as an arbiter of justice. So that poses for us, you know, in our gathering, in this moment of grief, some serious questions like, what do we mean by justice? And who gets to do the justice? Who gets to make the justice? And so I'll say in our situation, there's so much energy being expended by others and sometimes even by ourselves to deny that we have grief, that our grief is real. So that we, you know, racialize in the way we're racialized. We don't experience structural racism. We don't experience violence or exclusion. We don't come from a long lineage of surviving and thriving through war, fascism, displacement. I mean, in this country, we've had generations of that. It's a story that says whatever harm we do experience is exceptional to some kind of normal, peaceful state of things. And I think we'd be hard pressed, though, to find that nonviolent kind of like zero point. And today I'll try to get into some of this. I think what we're doing when we ask for instance, disaggregated data, it's something about us knowing our grief is real, and it's something about us trying to tell about that grief to others. Asian Americans, just like all oppressed people throughout history, have both the violence of racism and white supremacy to deal with, and also the constant messaging and narrative that our experience isn't real, that exploited working class Asian people don't exist in this country, that we don't organize, that we don't show up in charts and graphs. But, you know, generations, literally generations of organizers or artists, teachers, revolutionaries have spent their lives and work doing the reverse, trying to give us the space, the language to affirm our realities. And we have that lineage, and we should own that lineage. And it seems we're in a moment of where people both within and outside this particular racialized experience of Asian America are finding it harder to pretend that the grievances aren't there. So it might just be that we're in this moment where both we and others are beginning to know them as real. I'm sure many of you were on this webinar by Tamara Knopper, I believe this was last week, where she was asking, what will we do with these grievances? Will they be for solidarity? In part because like identity and lived experience aren't enough. Like we have to have political analysis. We have to make connections between history and the present. We have to develop and struggle together to build interracial solidarity. Solidarity that's powerful enough to really defend each other. Or will this moment of grief be used to prop up this fantasy of a nonviolent kind of zero point? Will it be used to bolster the normal state of things? And I should say, you know, the normal state of things is an economy whose qualities include radical, unprecedented inequality, centuries of legislated, legalized anti-Black extraction, unprecedented global military violence. Like, we can't ignore those contexts because those are the structures of violence where these moments of discrete incidents of violence that are shocking percolate up. It's the sea that we're in. Something I appreciate just about the title of this gathering is that it refers to anti-Asian racism, and specifically not anti-Asian hate or anti-Asian violence. Because I think what violence is shocking, or what violence is recognizable even as violence, is a political project. And so we're taking sides immediately as we utter those words. So with this in mind, I'm gonna turn to one aspect of structural violence that I focus on, It's been a site of reform, and it exists as a kind of public secret of white supremacy and racism. It's this criminal legal system, and particularly its intersection with the workplace. And for today's purposes, I'm just going to walk through this as a brief rundown on the basic point that there's compounding racism and anti-Blackness at the intersection between the criminal legal system and work. And let's use this as an example of a kind of longstanding structural violence that's existed for decades as ordinary and normal, and only recently, relatively, has a general consensus emerged that it's an engine of racial violence and class violence, and in fact, has, you know, it's a reconfigured form of caste or slavery that will define our era. So what we finally begun, or at least what we can sort of generally refer to as this quote unquote era of mass incarceration. And I like to start with this graphic. What's happened in the criminal legal system in the past 40 years since the Black Power and liberation movements of 60s and 70s is radical. I'm not using that word to refer to the root. I'm saying that it's the result of centuries of structural racism across several central institutions that we all need to survive. Those institutions represent the floor of human survival and flourishing. So that's housing, food, clean water, clean air, space to make mistakes, healthcare, spaces to learn and share, tools to do one's work. So here, the example of the criminal legal system, it's the air we breathe. And we know that after the Black Power and liberation movements, there's been an active radical deterioration of social service, public health, welfare functions of government, replaced instead with police, jails, prisons, various monitoring and surveillance programs. It's a historical dynamic. The uprising in May and June last year in response to George Floyd's murder brought again and again to the public, to public spaces, this to the forefront. It's calls to defund the police on municipal levels. And let's note that these aren't just calls for police accountability, but against living conditions. So radical inequalities, police, those inequalities that police function to enforce and maintain. So you can see that, for instance, in Law for Black Lives, Breathe Act, and you can see that immediately, that it's a structural critique. So let me see here. Massive, I guess one immediate point is that this is a massive system of racialized punishment and financial extraction that passes as normal. And we're really a global outlier in this. And at the same time, justice is bound up with it. So it's justice is a story that it tells. Justice is its brand. And Prison Policy Institute did some great graphics work. Let me see where I'm at in this. Here we go. Putting individual states alongside entire countries of a similar size. So I pulled out Massachusetts here. For Massachusetts, that's meant about 20% of the adult population has an arrest or conviction record. And another organization, the Sentencing Project, concluded that a significant portion of this can be traced back to multiple points in which system actors can choose to release someone. So what's happening here? And this is just a national number. What I normally say in this kind of presentation is that both the economy, like workplaces, the labor market, and the prison industrial complex rely on each other to determine, on the one hand, who's hireable, and on the other hand, who's releasable. So if you have a job, it's easier to get released on bail, you know, depending on various factors. But then on the other hand, in front of a potential employer, maybe you don't have a record, or maybe you do, and that can mark you as a proxy for good character, someone that's reliable, et cetera. But something else is also happening at the same time. And so I'm gonna skip this for the sake of time, which is that I'll point to these two graphs. The first one on the right side, of your screen was done by the Brennan Center in a report they released just a few months ago. Since September, I think it was released, where they found that Black workers without a record earn less annually than white workers with one. So that really builds on studies that there's an older study on the left side of the screen that shows that Black applicants without a record receive less callbacks from potential employers than white applicants with a record. The point here is that anti-Black racism shapes work opportunities more, and in addition to the presence of an arrest or conviction record. Let me exit out of this. So you got the shortest version of the charts of numbers advocating for campaigns of like ban the box. But I'm happy to connect you afterwards to talk through or share research. I think I'm up on time. I have a little bit more to talk through, but we can pause there for now.
Thank you so much. Yeah, thank you so much, Han, for your great talk, and especially for bringing attention back to some of these structural issues, which is, you know, really what I have been hoping for these conversations, and really kind of setting up this discussion about work and inequality and incarceration that all kind of go together to perpetuate racism against you know, multiple populations in the US. So the next speaker is Christina Ong, who I believe is going to be talking about some of the histories of organizing to help situate this current moment. So Christina, please take the floor.
Thank you, Vivian, and thank you, Han, for that presentation. I think it actually dovetails really nicely with what I'll be talking about today. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen, and hopefully everybody can see the screen here. Can I get a thumbs up if you can see it? Perfect, thank you so much. Okay, so just to give a brief visual description, I'm a Chinese American woman with long brown hair wearing matching green glasses and a green cardigan. And so I'm really excited today to be talking to you all about the history and the legacy of Asian American activism stemming from the 1970s. I think that the surge of Asian and Asian American activism that so many of us are seeing today is really uplifting, but it's also interesting to note that it's not necessarily something that's really arising out of this current moment or arising out of nowhere. And I think that it's really helpful, at least for me, to situate not only that this violence has a historical legacy against Asian Americans and Asians in this country, but also the kinds of varied activism and solutions that we're seeing Asian American communities ask for has a historical legacy as well. So today, again, I'll be focusing on the kinds of community-based activism that sprang up in Manhattan's Chinatown in the early 1970s. And this work is based off of doctoral work that I've been conducting since 2018. And I actually have my dissertation proposal defense in 2 weeks. So this is great practice for me. Thank you, everybody. So during the 1960s and the 1970s, as Han mentioned, or made note of the Black Power and Black Liberation movements of this time, those who came to classify themselves as Asian American, because this term was not a term that existed prior to 1968, were really inspired by both the Black Power movement, but also anti-Vietnam War activism, and also the Third World Liberation Front and the fight for ethnic studies. And Asian Americans fought alongside many of these groups and also developed their own forms of activism against racism in the US. So these social movements helped unleash what Asian American poet and activist the late Faye Chang described as a visceral sense of not belonging to a country that many were born and raised in. And this kind of ostracization and otherness that we're even still seeing today is this has resulted in the kind of dichotomy that Asian Americans have one of two options. Either we forge a place within an existing Black-white racial dichotomy, or we have a complete dismantling of this racial regime. And Karen Ishizuka, who wrote a book on the Asian American movement during this time that was published in 2016, talked about how the Asian American movement of the 70s and into the 80s wasn't necessarily a question of legitimacy or representation. That's more in alignment with what the civil rights movement had asked for, but more of liberation and freedom from oppression, which is a goal much more in alignment with the Black Panthers and also the Puerto Rican Young Lords. So in 1970, one such group of Asian Americans who believed in liberation comprised East Coast's first Pan-Asian political and arts organization. And they were called the Basement Workshop, primarily because they were active in a basement in Chinatown. And they were housed in Manhattan's Chinatown formally from 1970 to 1986. But even though they ended their activism in 1986 formally, they helped produce such cultural institutions that still exist today, such as the Museum of Chinese in America and the Asian American Arts Center. And this young group of Asian Americans are primarily of Chinese and Japanese descent, but they later incorporated members of Korean and Filipino ancestry as they expanded. Its origins sort of stem from 1969, and you can see in the slide that's on your screen, one of the like early meeting minutes. The group at the time called itself the Chinese Professionals Workshop because they were comprised primarily of Hong Kong international students at Columbia University and Chinese American academics and young professionals, hence professionals. But they actually changed their name pretty soon after because they started incorporating members of other Asian ethnic groups. So all the members of Basement Workshop were activists, artists, and intellectuals, and they believed strongly in serving the community in Chinatown because that's where the organization was based in, even if most of them or about half of them were not actually ethnically Chinese. So Chinatown didn't just become like this like Chinese ethnic place, but it became a place for them to cultivate a stronger connection to their Asian American identity. And that is where they learned the ideas of serving the communities and what that would mean for them. So Basement Workshop members also rarely organize in isolation. I think it's really important for us to note in our contemporary moment that activism is never done in isolation. In 1970, the US government would conduct the first mail census, census by mail instead of like physical knocking on doors. And this sort of echoes our 2020 census and how important it is for marginalized communities to have been counted. At the time in 1970, many young members of the Chinatown community realized that a mail in census would be problematic because a lot of residents in Chinatown lived in multi-generational households. A lot of them lived in units that were not actually legally sanctioned for multiple like residents to be in. So if it was a mail-in census, only like one family out of the 2, 3, or 4, or 5 would be counted. And so Basement Workshop members alongside other community members worked as part of the Chinese Community Census Committee, which was all volunteer run, organizing people to call, knock on doors, translate and educate the broader community about the importance of being counted in the census. Especially important because many of the migrant workers in Chinatown were worried because some were undocumented and they also feared being counted in the census. Additionally, in 1971, so this is actually 50 years to, not to the day, but to the around time period, they organized a free public health fair to provide health screenings and health information to Chinatown residents, because at the time, the nearest hospital to Chinatown didn't have staff that actually spoke fluent various Chinese dialects. So early Basement Workshop members like the late Corky Lee helped to coordinate the fair and build booths, and other volunteers like Merle Okada, who told me she was one of the only women at the time to not get queasy from the sight of blood. They were trained by nurses to give blood, or to take blood samples from seniors for health screenings. So the health fair actually gave way to the establishment of the Chinatown Health Clinic, which eventually shared a unit with a later Basement Workshop location. This is a slide of some sub-company members of the Basement Workshop who organized the community planning workshop that focused particularly on planning programs for Chinatown community members, including weekend ESL classes. And there are many other kinds of community-based or educational programs coordinated by Basement as well. I forgot to time myself, so hopefully I don't run over time, but if I do, one of our lovely coordinators can let me know. So something that is really, really interesting, and I think the thing that excites me the most about Basement Workshop was that they utilize their art as forms of activism, which is, again, something that we're seeing emerge so much in the contemporary moment with Asian American artists utilizing their art as platforms for engagement and political activism. So Yellow Pearl was a 57-page arts anthology inspired by the lyrics and music of A Grain of Sand, and they were the first trio of Asian American folk musicians, Nobuko Miyamoto, Charlie Chin, and Chris Ijima, who toured the country in the late 60s and into the 70s. And they also became members of Basement Workshop. And this arts anthology comprised themes of anti-imperialism, poverty, legacies of migration, and gender issues within the Asian American community. And it was poetry, music, and lyrics. I mean, it wasn't like the actual music because it's the book, but lyrics and like line notes. And Yellow Pearl exhibited the diverse political interests within the Asian American organizing community. And it demonstrates the intricacies of what concerned Asian Americans at the time. So you can see here, there were many contributors in the black bar to Yellow Pearl. It was co-coordinated by Chinese American Arlen Huang and Japanese American Takashi Yanagita, who are both pictured here in the basement at 54 Elizabeth Street. Arlen is pictured with his wife, Lillian Ling. They were not married at the time, but many couples emerged from basement workshop. And I think it's a testament to the sort of intensity of the time and actually just they spent all hours of their young lives at basement coordinating activist programs. And I think we're also seeing that today with a lot of young Asian American activists spending a lot of their time with other community members organizing for social justice. Another important production that exemplifies the legacy of Asian American activism, art, and intellectual work is the organization's Bridge magazine, and it's the longest running Asian American magazine that started in 1971 and ended in the mid 80s. Bridge published movie, book, and theater reviews of Asian American productions and poetry, photography, but they also published articles regarding a range of political issues in the US, and they solicited like article submissions from Asian Americans around the country and also internationally. For example, in the 1974 editorial, like letter from the editor, the team covered issues particularly regarding the mass media's racist characterizations of Chinatowns as riddled with violence and juvenile delinquency, and condemned their lack of the media's lack of understanding of where those legacies come from, segregation, and lack of welfare or social services for young Asian Americans in Chinatowns. And they also documented coalitional action between Puerto Rican and Chinese communities in their efforts to gain bilingual teachers in public schools in New York City's Lower East Side. So a range of domestic issues were covered. In 1972, during the presidential election, again, something that I'm seeing a lot of echoes with the elections that, well, now we have a new president and an administration, but the elections from last year, Bridge, because they were the only like national Asian American magazine, represented a diverse range of Asian American interests, and they wanted to engage their political leaders with issues that were of importance to their Asian American readers, because they felt that no other media outlet would ask these sorts of questions. So they actually sent a letter in the days where you could just write a letter to, like a manual letter to your presidential candidates. They sent a letter and questionnaire to every single candidate asking them to send back responses so that they could be published in the following issue. So I will post up, these were the questions that were sent. You can skim them at your leisure. And if people have questions, I can also like send the PDF of the magazine if people want full information about the responses. But these questions sort of highlight what kinds of key issues were to Basement Workshop members and their readership, including US migration policies and discrimination of particular ethnic minorities. And a lot of, I just reread this in order to like prepare for the presentation. And I feel like you could probably put this questionnaire out today and a lot of it would be the same concerns that Asian Americans have today. I mean, you might need to change a couple of the details and the president's names in the questionnaire, but a lot of the themes would still be relevant today. So responses were published in the following issue, as I mentioned, and some of the presidential candidates actually did reply in very long responses. The five asterisks on the left under response indicate the candidates who did reply in depth. We had acknowledgments from other candidates that basically said, like, they sent a form letter that said, thanks for your inquiry. We're really busy, so we can't say anything. And then they also had two responses. And this took up 12 pages of the issue, which is to me, a large amount of like one issue of a magazine. Normally in a magazine on like political issues with like even like an interview with the president, it wouldn't be that long. So it indicates to me that the Bridge magazine editorialship really, really cared about presenting presidential candidates' broad opinions to the readership without condensing or like putting in their own tone or voice in order to allow Asian Americans who are reading to really understand what the platforms of these candidates were. And I only included on the right side a very, very short sample of two of the responses from two of the candidates, Shirley Chisholm and Louis Fisher, regarding the war in Vietnam and the racial nature of the war. So as Han mentioned, I think it's really important to contextualize everything that's been happening. This rise of anti-Asian violence in the current day does not happen in a vacuum. We are still in a pandemic. Over a year later, Black people are still active in the movement for Black lives against police violence. And as Han mentioned, Derek Chauvin's trial started just this week. There are still ongoing deportation orders. We still have an influx of unaccompanied minors at the border, at the U.S.-Mexico border. There are now 25 states since this morning, I guess, in the U.S. that have introduced legislation to ban medical care for transgender youth. And all of these things are happening at the same time as this sort of endemic violence against Asian Americans, which is what has brought us here to talk today. And it's very, very overwhelming, but I also think it's important to recognize that no other kind of systemic violence in history has ever occurred in a vacuum, and that these violences have always been informed by one another. And just like these violences, maybe optimistically, our solutions and our avenues for activism can and should be informed by one another as well. So I'll end it with this slide of a poem by Fei Chang. So while members of Basement Workshop were not organizing against anti-Asian racism in the midst of a pandemic or during periods of this endemic physical randomized violence against people of Asian descent, they recognized that oppression was consistent and ongoing. So they understood from the beginning of their organizing that racism wasn't just physical, but it was emotional and psychological, and that these violences required a myriad of solutions, both community-based and arts-based, and academic as well. And seeing the divisions in tactics, priorities, and visions amongst Asian and Asian American communities today reminds me of the work of these activist elders. I wasn't able to get too much into it, but they also had lots of different opinions and lots of infighting. And I think that doesn't make them any less important, but their work in constantly negotiating those difficult terrains of understanding and then enacting political consciousness as Asian Americans ultimately created the space for actual tangible social change. So it's my hope that we hold on to those lessons of finding strength amongst our larger communities as opposed to fearing that kind of confrontation, and that we can move from being overwhelmed, as I know we all are, to finding wisdom in how we can work to address anti-Asian racism in our own ways. And that for those of us who feel lost, it's as simple as saying, change is in our hands, it's time. So I'll end there.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Christina, for that wonderful presentation and historical contextualization of Asian American politics, right? And right now, there's a lot of, there's a lot of attention to this idea that Asian America, Asian Americans are kind of finding a new type of political voice. We're seeing a lot of reference, for instance, to hashtags like Stop Asian Hate. And so, Christina, I think your presentation is really important in situating what some of these histories of activism look like. So our last presenter is Elena Shih. And Elena, I think your timing in this panel is really great because you're bringing in some of this political organizing work with these questions of work and legal restrictions and things like that. So I think this is just really great timing. So Elena, take it away. And thank you so much for speaking with us.
Thank you so much, Vivian. Thanks to faculty and staff at the Harvard Asia Center. And it is really an honor to be here presenting with Han and Christina, because there's so many overlaps between our presentations, and I'm very, very excited to continue this conversation about systems and structures. And thanks to all the audience members for being here. Just 2 days before the brutal mass shootings in Atlanta, a plane deported 33 Vietnamese American refugees to Vietnam after some had lived in the United States for decades as part of a long legacy of the more than 400% increase in the deportation of Southeast Asian refugees during the Trump administration. Southeast Asian organizations have been fighting against these systems of state-sanctioned violence. They argue in particular that the historic legacies of U.S. imperial and military projects in Southeast Asia make the U.S. absolutely culpable to the systemic marginalization and over-policing of Southeast Asian refugee communities in the United States today. Yet activist pleas have largely fallen to silent ears. While President Biden was heralded for swift calls to pass anti-hate crimes legislation, he was actively endorsing deportation. And I hope our work today can grapple with some of this erasure while holding space for the enormous outpouring of grief for anti-Asian violence that has targeted particularly women and elders in the United States. As we reckon with the surge in anti-Asian racism or the visibility of it, I continually return to lessons shared to me by the director of the Southeast Asian Freedom Network, Sarath Sung, who has given me a mantra for this time, which is that we cannot contend with anti-AAPI hate without a broad understanding of state-sanctioned violence. So as we continue to mourn the loss of life and the brutal act of white supremacist, misogynist, anti-immigrant and anti-sex work terror on March 16th, my talk today seeks to underscore the systemic injustices that have caused Asian massage workers to be the targets of state and interpersonal violence for decades. And I think you'll see a lot of overlaps between what Han and Christina have already shared. In the days after the attack, media requests abounded and they reached out to Red Canary Song asking two primary questions. The first was around whether or not these workers were sex workers. And that of course gestured to the adjacent question of whether or not they were victims of human trafficking. The second focused on whether or not we could elaborate on how horrible or squalid working conditions are for these women, as if to generate more sympathy for their deaths. Both of these questions seem to detach the violence experienced on March 16th from larger systems, systems of precarity that low-wage migrant workers face and systems of violence that Asian massage workers face because their industry has been associated with human trafficking. In the past decade, Asian massage work has been the target of anti-trafficking organizations who amass millions of dollars around projects that define, and this is an actual new legal category defined by the American Anti-Trafficking Organization, the Polaris Project, illicit massage businesses as locusts of human trafficking. Nearly all of these interventions have called for the heightened surveillance and policing of massage businesses, which has resulted in hundreds of raids across the country. However, it is often at the hands of police officers who conduct such raids that migrant Asian massage workers suffer the most harm. And here I share a visual created by the Asia Pacific Network of Sex Workers, underscoring the idea that rescue is in fact violence. While anti-trafficking raids claim to save and protect trafficked women from violence and abuse, their effect has been to bring additional surveillance and exploitation to these places of work. In 2017, Song Yang, a migrant Chinese woman working in Flushing, Queens, was chased out of her fourth floor window to her death during a police raid on the massage business where she worked. The circumstances of Song Yang's death drew suspicion as she had previously filed a complaint of sexual assault against a police officer and subsequently became a target for harassment and threats from members of law enforcement. Organizers of Red Canary Song, a grassroots coalition of migrant sex workers and allies, noted that Song Yang would rather have fallen to her death than risk arrest, imprisonment, and potential deportation. This widespread crackdown on Asian massage work has introduced new and novel systems of what I've characterized as auxiliary policing, and which Han has already talked about, dispersing policing from the hands of law enforcement and dispatching them to a whole new regime of everyone from civilian vigilantes, college students who want to rescue Asian sex slaves, and various new brokers of policing. And in particular, my recent research has traced the emergence of a whole new slew of licensing measures introduced in over a dozen states that specifically target Asian massage work. And I think Han's work and the work of NELP has already pointed to the numerous ways in which licensure in the United States has been used as a way to bureaucratize and police racialized poverty. So I'll give you a little glimpse into what that looks like here. Where I live in Providence, Rhode Island, in 2016, our governor Gina Raimondo passed a law that introduced a new category of Asian quote unquote body work, which required a distinct license from that of a massage therapist. In order to receive such licenses, Asian body workers in all, you know, these numerous states that have them must submit to criminal background checks, citizenship requirements, English language tests, high school diplomas, and exorbitantly costly technical certificates. The municipal ordinance instigating this particular law in Providence specifically sought to target Asian massage businesses following quote unquote Operation Rubdown, which was first initiated in 2003, which according to our research has resulted in the closing of hundreds of Asian massage businesses in the past two decades. During anti-trafficking raids, such as the famed Orchids of Asia Day Spa, which involved New England Patriots owner Robert Kraft, workers are often arrested for the mere infraction of not having a license. The initial sneak in, even though widespread media outrage around this always points to threats of human trafficking and always really, really, really celebrates these raid and rescue operations. The initial sneak and peek warrant in the Kraft case was actually issued after a public health investigator arrived at Orchids to conduct a routine health investigation. So the initial arrests were prompted by a citation unrelated to prostitution or trafficking at all. In the public records around the case, the inspector's report noted that she had received training on how to identify victims of human trafficking, which include the presence of suitcases, clothes, a fridge full of food, and condoms as evidence. At Orchids in particular, she recorded that the signs of trafficking present included a young Asian woman who was quote unquote dressed provocatively, spoke quote unquote little English, appeared nervous, and avoided eye contact with her. And I'll footnote also to say that these trainings are part of a nationwide campaign of different kinds of ways to identify victims of human trafficking that appear everywhere from like the Flushing Public Library to educate civilians on how to report on Asian massage businesses to airline professionals to truckers. There's now an organization called Truckers Against Trafficking that purely trains truck drivers on how to report instances of what they see are trafficking, but usually using highly racialized proxy indicators of poverty, recent immigration, things like that. So heading back to the Robert Kraft case, by April 2019, prosecutors conceded that there was not a single case of trafficking amongst all the workers who had been arrested that day. And while Kraft's misdemeanor prostitution solicitation charges were summarily dropped in September 2020, several of the low-wage migrant Chinese workers arrested in the raids were handed over to ICE custody because they were undocumented. One worker was held for months in ICE custody awaiting deportation proceedings while being transferred to multiple immigration and detention facilities. During this time, the state seized $2,900 from a personal bank account under civil forfeiture proceedings, while another worker was held for 5 months before being released. Other workers with green cards or citizenship were jailed, fined, and released, only to find their old workplace shut down, forcing them into the precarious position of looking for new options for work, massage work being just one of a limited number of options for migrant low-wage workers in the service and manufacturing sectors. this last point is important because most anti-trafficking projects that aim to save Asian women by rescuing them from sex work never consider that these very workers have already and sometimes concurrently work in a host of other low-wage service sector industries, including as home care workers, restaurant workers, garment workers, but these are never the organizing labor campaigns that get attention. These new forms of policing intersect, of course, with the devastating economic impacts of the coronavirus. Massage workers began feeling the impacts of the coronavirus pandemic as early as the beginning of January, as our outreach told us. Workers reported experiencing a sharp decline in business as people began avoiding Chinatowns and Asian-owned businesses for fears of the coronavirus. At that time, they reported earnings of just $20 to $30 a day. Following the official countrywide closures of businesses in March, as tens of thousands of people around the country lost their jobs, Asian massage workers that we outreached to with Red Canary Song faced additional obstacles. A large number of them are undocumented and consequently not eligible for state aid, but even those who are documented really feared applying for unemployment insurance and or receiving any sort of government help because of Trump's public charge rule, which unveiled at the end of February of last year, subjected immigrants to scrutiny for accessing social welfare benefits. The fears generated by the public charge rule have also led migrant workers to refrain from reaching out for testing and medical care when they need it due to the notion that seeking medical services may negatively impact their pathways to legal residency. In Toronto, the migrant sex worker rights organization Butterfly recorded the account of one massage worker who received 5 tickets for living on site at her workplace, despite the discovery that she was doing this to distance herself from her parents after displaying COVID-19 symptoms. In closing, I hope that our discussion can continue to draw links between the very individual acts of violence that we are seeing and the large systems that enable them to exist. Understanding the root causes of anti-Asian racism requires contending with the dual nodes of, on one hand, state-sanctioned violence like policing and deportation, along with another hand of what I think maybe we don't talk about as enough, maybe it's really, really, really unique to trafficking, but the putatively benevolent attempts to rescue ideal Asian victims while also bracketing then who are not deserving and deserving to be criminalized. While discounting the material needs of low-wage migrant workers. I think for far too long, the two threads have worked in tandem to simplify the needs of Asian migrant communities and justify their surveillance and policing. And one final slide that I wanted to share, because this is the Asia Center, and I haven't fully figured out a way of how we bring this all together, is not only working across coalitions and building solidarities there, but I think that transnationally, it's been incredibly inspiring to see organized labor at the front lines of protesting the coup in Myanmar. This is a photo shared by the Federation of Garment Workers of Myanmar. It was one of the newest garment unions, nearly entirely founded by young women working in the garment industry, founded in late 2020. Late 2019. So just before the coronavirus hit, they were already finding incredible ways of organizing. And it was through that organizing experience that also sustained them through organizing against the kinds of corporate violence enacted on them during the COVID pandemic, as different suppliers, manufacturers, and retailers pulled out of contracts in specific factories that have made them one of the most dangerous sources to contend with and at the front lines of this coup. So it's been really paradoxical that the government, in addition to cracking down on everybody specifically, is issuing warrants for the arrest of 12 labor leaders, has blacklisted 14 labor unions. And I think the answer to that is because labor has been so organized. And as I think to how we approach or attack different kinds of state sanctioned violence, it seems to be always returning to the idea of supporting workers and supporting workers' ability to do their work. Thank you.
Thank you so much for this wonderful presentation. I'm going to offer a few quick comments and then a framing question, and then I think we'll open it up to the floor. And I encourage our speakers today to answer as much or as little of these comments and questions as you want. And I think the Asia Center will be moderating some of those questions. So some ideas that come to mind as I listen to all of your wonderful presentations were some of the overlaps between among all the things that you said. And one thing that occurs to me is that all of your presentations touched on this question of connectivity across different communities, right? And we can see that in terms of Asian Americans and Asians in relation to other communities, say, Black American communities, and what types of politics come out of that. But also we can think about that in terms of the diversity within what we call AAPI, right? And so I think Han's point about disaggregation really is resonant throughout all the presentations. Today, I think we spoke primarily about gender and socioeconomic status and immigration within this context, but we can also disaggregate to think about ethnicity. We didn't talk about that as much today, but something that we should consider. And I think even when we think about this moniker that has come out of this moment, which is stop Asian hate or stop AAPI hate, we can see how there's this tension by which at the same time we can build broader coalitions and kind of build solidarity across different communities. There's a potential for erasure to happen within that as well. So like specifically with the hashtag stop AAPI hate, there has been some pushback, for instance, from Pacific Islander communities that have pointed out that the ways that Pacific Islander communities are racialized can be uneven, right? And it's not, while some people from these communities do get racialized as looking like other Asian people, many times that is not the case, right? And so when we talk about racism and its impacts, we have to really think through how racism in its many forms affects communities very differently, right? Another theme that really touched upon was this question of racial violence and racism in relation to capitalism, right? And so I think I found that point to be really salient. And so when we think about violence, right, in again, multiple forms, some of the things that the presenters talked about were surveillance, incarceration, as well as these very extreme forms of violence. What we found is that working conditions and the economy broadly and how that shapes migration is really at the center of much of these questions, right? And I think that what that does when we think about these broader structures of inequality and how that dovetails with violence, what we can see is that oftentimes racial violence and racial capitalism itself are not recognizable, right? There are ways in which, racial violence impacts people, but within public discourse, there isn't necessarily this language for speaking about it in the mainstream in this way that is critical, right? And so, like, for instance, we can think about some of the police responses to the massacres in Atlanta, this kind of taking at his word, alleged perpetrator's, description of himself as having a sex addiction, right? And that somehow then no longer being evidence of racism, right? Or racialized misogyny. We can think about how, capitalism and the ways in which people get dehumanized, according to their backgrounds and according to what types of work they are in is very much part of this erasure. And then finally, before I go to the kind of framing question, which I know I'm speaking a lot, I do think that we also have this question about what is the role of the law, right? And so something that's come out of this moment is this attention to anti-Asian racism in terms of being hate crimes, in terms of being, forms of violence. And what that has generated is both a sort of social response, right, but also a legal response. And so there's a lot of discussion about using this moment to pass anti-hate crime laws that would then rely on police to kind of intervene in these situations more. So I think that as we talk critically about, incarceration and systems of policing, thinking about how this moment is kind of propping up this new plans to expand surveillance and criminalization is definitely part of that as well. So with that, the question I would love for the presenters to think about, and again, you can speak as much to that or as little to that as you want, is what is the work of this moment, right? And so, we are in this moment in which, as I said earlier, we're not necessarily witnessing an increase in anti-Asian racism, but there's certainly a greater visibility around it, right? And so as we kind of grapple with this recent intensification of attention by the media, by our governments and other institutions, I want the presenters to think about what is distinct about this moment? And in this distinction, what are the key opportunities and challenges of this moment for Asian American politics? Asian American politics broadly defined, right? So with that, I think we can open up to questions. I think the Asia Center is moderating that. But yeah, thank you again for your presentations. And I look forward to some of your responses to these questions that have emerged.
Vivian, really hitting it hard with these questions here. In my presentation, I talked about how there's these linkages that I'm seeing with activism from the 70s and basement workshop with the contemporary moment or series of moments. So in a lot of ways, I don't see it at this particular moment or series of moments as uniquely distinct to this political time in our nation's long history. While at the same time, I do think there are, of course, differences. One being the advent of social media and the influx in very visceral forms and evidence of anti-Asian physical violence committed against people of Asian descent in this country, or people who are assumed to be of Asian descent, right? Because some folks who are being attacked are not actually Asian American, or they don't self-identify as Asian American, right? So, So I think the advent of social media and this like heightened hyper awareness that is happening, not just like in the broad public, but I think Asian Americans ourselves, our own communities, are like really forced to confront what is happening. And the only like sort of similar thing that I can call back to in the 1970s that activists I've talked to have discussed was the instances of an imagery of the Vietnam War and US aggression in the war, because they didn't have social media. They couldn't like turn to other channels or go on their phone and like avoid the news. It was like on the radio, in magazines like the Time magazine cover, and on television constantly. And so in that way, I see there is some sort of similarity, but I think this visceral influx and like constant barrage is really hard for us to grapple with both emotionally and then move forward to make sort of political engagements, both within our own like intra-Asian communities and with the broader public. And I don't necessarily know what the solution for that is. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah.
I'm not gonna say I have any solutions like as a map, but I do think that we develop new questions and we develop solutions through that organizing. It's just through practice. I mean, we are so atomized. We don't recognize each other's harm. We can't see so many forms of violence that happens to others. And I think it's that practice of recognition and trying to build defense that will get us closer to solidarity. I did want to touch on the point of, I guess, the role of the law in all of this. And it was something that I wanted to talk about today in general. I guess like I think I have some invitational kind of ideas around it, but I guess I wanted to say that the status of our legal racialization, and by legal racialization, I just mean, you know, historical access to wages for your labor, the right to own property, the right to a jury, the right to be a witness, which in reality just means the right to testify against a white person, basically, in court, whether what you say is recognized as reality, the right to inherit, all these things, the right to marry, all these things. So that all of that, I think, is best really understood through two competing and sometimes contrary lens, which is the permanent wars that the US is engaged in abroad, but then simultaneously at home, the racialization of Black and Indigenous people, the status of their organizing, their uprising, the movements in relation to institutions that uphold primarily anti-Black and anti-Indigenous violence. And so I think we can look at this moment really in that way, and media is sort of holding them up as separate incidents. But I do see the prosecution of the officer who murdered George Floyd as in conversation with the demand for hate crimes. I mean, it's the same hate crime prosecution. It's the same dodging of sort of the reality of structural racism and racial capitalism to say that these are bad apples, to say that these are individuals who can be somehow held responsible by a criminal justice system that we are just emerging to understand as an engine of racism. And so in some way, by demanding more prosecution through the criminal justice system, in some way is being used to discipline Black and like abolitionist demands for a rethinking and dismantling of these systems of punishment. And so we should pay attention to that when we demand justice. Like, I think that's the space that we need to move through. I don't know if there's like this causal relation that I'm suggesting, so that's why I'm saying it's more of an invitation, but I do know in my home state of Louisiana, the Asian people, East Asian people, were counted as white until like 1870. It flipped that year. We were counted as colored, and then it flipped again. You know, like, it just goes back and forth. Of course, on the state level, these laws change and are different, but I do think that there's a relationship there, and part of our work is to really reveal it to each other, and so that we can sit with it and move on it. Whiteness too, though, and I'll end on this point, whiteness too isn't some abstract thing. You can also see it as just an alliance. It's a historical economic alliance that changes throughout time. Sometimes that's, you know, sometimes it's defined against Catholicism. Sometimes it's defined against Jewishness. Sometimes it's primarily defined against Blackness and defined against indigeneity. Like, those are an Asianness. And so I think we can, if we begin thinking of it as an object, then we can think of it as an object that can be dismantled, as opposed to some kind of like ether, or like, I don't know how to say, but just some kind of thing that we can't even hold.
Actually, so we do have a question from the audience, which is along these lines in terms of what are some of your thoughts on hate crime legislation, right? And I know, Han, you just touched on that, but Elena, as you comment, if you want to address this, please feel free to do so.
Yes, thank you, Vivian, for just the general invitation to think towards solutions. And thank you so much to Christine and Han for bringing in particular the ways that one solution is just so obviously there in cross-racial alliances and a deep, deep, deep sense of like empathy and reaching out. I think that there is an urgency of this moment that we need to shake. And I think I can't speak to like everybody, but I think I'm going to speak specifically to like what it would mean to like speak to like an elementary school student, and what it would mean to speak like to my grandma if she was still alive, because everybody in the middle is a lot more maybe, I think these are the hardest people, right? Because you have, like, with, I did a talk, and a lot of like this content is all about like sexual violence. And a high school teacher in Long Island said, I really don't know how to like convey this material to young people who are really, really broken and hurting. And I think that the long work of fighting for ethnic studies and fighting like youth fighting just for the correct histories to exist in their curriculum and in rewriting their curriculum in Rhode Island, students, high school students have sued the state for inadequate civics education. I found that to be so, so, so instructive. I think that there's a way that we need to tell everyone that you don't have to like grieve and have a response immediately. Like we feel like we're only going to capture the news cycle for the next 2 weeks. And in many ways, like that was kind of true. Like there was another mass shooting in Boulder and it was as if we had those 2 weeks and then, you know, we sort of have to figure it out on our own. I think giving ourselves time and encouraging people around us that like it takes a long time means that you can process the multiple stages of grief. For my students, it was constantly this sense that like the pain and suffering and microaggressions and different forms of like systemic violence they had experienced their whole lives were invisible until this very moment. And suddenly they could connect and there was this outpouring like, okay, people get it. And they're only going to get it for this brief amount of time. And I think that like platforms like these and continuing to have them, and I hope we can continue to have them, means that like we continue to make sure that that is part of a discussion and that attending to things like the longstanding needs of curricular change at the like educational level for young people is so important, so that early on, these are the lessons and these are the solidarities that they built. Like Christina, I hope that every, you know, like I grew up in New York and didn't know, you know, never got to see any of those beautiful pictures. Like happened to be lucky to know Faye, but like, why isn't that a part of the education in New York City schools? All right, so then there's that. And then for the elders, it is like the really, really difficult, mundane work of having all of these, like these things that these conversations that we're having translated and translatable into different languages, because that's, you know, I can function and like do research in China, but then if you want me to like have like a really, really, if you want me to have this discussion and a really nuanced discussion with elders, I can't always do it. And so it's about, I love like some of the toolkits and like, you know, language translation guides that some folks have been putting out. I think that those are really, really, really critical to a lot of the work. And so I think that like these like mundane efforts on both ends are really, really going to change things at the polls. And I think for the rest of us who are already engaged in different ways, it's really clearly about supporting the work of organizing that's been happening for decades and continuing to support it outside of this moment. And the only thing I've learned about hate crimes legislation from like the abolitionist thinkers that comprise Red Canary who've informed me is that there kind of is a parallel to, and that it's just, it's things are never gonna be solved if we turn to the criminal legal system, as like Han will probably be able to shed much more light on, but there's an interesting parallel between like hate crimes legislation that tries to penalize a perpetrator and end demand legislation, which hopes to just penalize buyers of sex by way of curbing the industry, but decriminalize. And so in our work, when we're talking about systems of criminalization, we absolutely advocate full decriminalization, not just of codes of prostitution, but of sex work and all the adjacent categories that are able to penalize sex work simply by their proximity to commercial sex.
Yeah, thank you so much. And I think that it's useful to point out that, you know, some of these discussions about hate crimes legislation, I think there's much more attention to these questions right now because of our particular media moment. But these discussions have existed for a long time. I mean, I remember when I was in graduate school, I had a colleague who was doing his dissertation on this research, and this was, you know, close to a decade ago. So, and he wasn't the first either, right? So you know, oftentimes within specific moments, discussions become much more visible, but that doesn't mean that they are starting for the first time. And I think, you know, Elena, as you're speaking, I was thinking about the, you know, this idea of pace, right? And the pace of politics and what the urgency of particular moments, especially in the context of a 24-hour news cycle where it seems like the opportunity is so truncated and that it's so condensed to say like a week or two, how that affects organizing. And, you know, I mentioned this in my class, I teach environment and inequality here at Harvard. But one thing I mentioned was the labor involved with organizing. And as you had mentioned, this bombardment of requests. Right. You can even see a similar parallel, not even to, you know, the organizing that Red Canary Song has done, but also just in the context of other disasters. Like after a disaster, a lot of grassroots organizations receive, you know, an influx of resources. And part of the work is not only in distributing these resources, but knowing, you know, but the process of how to, right? Because a lot of these organizations don't necessarily have this infrastructure where they can deal with, you know, a huge influx, right? And so that becomes labor itself. And so I think that, you know, one of the calls that's very important is while understanding and embracing, you know, these moments as specifically urgent, to also build the infrastructure for longer term organizing, because movements are not just made, you know, over a week, right? They are sustained over a long period of time. And this sort of disproportionality of how resources get allocated within, you know, in accordance to, say, Biden or the media drawing attention to certain issues, and then, you know, dealing with scarcity, you know, over a longer period of time, you know, this can actually be an issue in and of itself. So I think that's a very important point that that we need to think about. You know, organizing is not simply just politics, it's also the labor around that. So I do see that there is another question, or maybe a couple of questions. So there's one of the questions is representation, right? And the person asking this question mentions the specific context of Asian medicine and how that gets taught in universities. I think we can think in you know, even beyond medicine, a lot of the ways that Asian cultures themes related to Asians, right, getting taught within universities, but not necessarily including actual Asian people within these contexts, right? And so, you know, the person asking this question is kind of asking about a need to reflect and correct. So what are some ways that institutions like universities and other institutions that we engage with, what are ways that they can address these issues and try to, you know, build capacity for, you know, greater equity in these types of conversations. And anyway, if you want to jump in, please feel free to, anyone who wants to.
I can't necessarily speak to medicine, and I know we're at time, so I don't want to take up too much of the remaining lack of seconds. But I do think, you know, the Elena mentioned ethnic studies as sort of this way to course correct and represent our histories or marginalized histories in our education system. And I think that that is one mechanism, at least having like intentional courses that are for credit and not this sort of like two-unit diversity thing that I know a lot of universities have, at least Pitt has done in the wake of the uprisings after George Floyd and Breonna Taylor. They have sort of like a mandatory freshman two-unit course. And so for all incoming students, which is great, but also it sort of leaves a gap in continuing that knowledge because there's no actual stream to continue that kind of learning. It's just like an intro course. And then there's no mechanism for like an actual certificate or minor or major to be done. So I feel like that is one avenue to actually input, put in resources and like take very seriously the role that those kinds of learnings should have for students and not just like a check mark box, like, okay, well, we did the diversity thing and all students took it, so now we're good. Because diversity and like and learning about our histories is not just going to be done in one course, right? And also the idea of like representing, like, oh, if I have or include an Asian faculty member, then that covers my bases. Because also I think we should recognize that not all people of Asian descent are going to be specializing or studying like racial justice or things about our communities. Like sometimes it's fine if an Asian academic studies, I don't know, like vampire literature or something totally unrelated to like what we're talking about today, right? And I think that we need to problematize this idea of like when we have an insert person representative from this ethnic or racial group, then that's going to cover our bases. And that means we're community oriented or like we care about Asian people and Asian culture because we have one Asian like professor in this department. So yeah, that's my little ending note.
Okay, great. So we are at time, but I did want to offer space for very brief final comments from the panelists. Please actually be brief. And I also have this problem of not being brief. So I won't judge you if you're not, but please try.
I just want to express thanks. There's so much overlap in our talks today, and I hope we can stay connected and that there'll be more spaces like this. I think one thing that I'm leaving with is just, we are in this moment. I think there is something that we're seeing, and that there's some questions to be asked right now, such as like, what are we gonna do with this grief or with this anger? And I would say that we should take Elena's point very seriously, which is that this urgency is fake. Like, this is false urgency. There's like real urgent things, and then there's like the pretend urgency of passing hate crime legislation, which on the one hand is like, we are asking for recognition of grievance, right? Like, that is real. But on the other hand, that isn't the site where we'll get actual reckoning with what's happening to us. So I'll leave it there, and thank you so much, y'all.
Thank you so much. I think that more opportunities, actually, this is responding to the Asian medicine question of closing that gap between Asian studies and area studies and Asian American studies, as this panel has done. Like, this is the first, you know, Center for Asia Studies that has actually put a talk that I've seen is important. Another really important way to move together to like bridge that gap and build transnational solidarities as well.
Yeah, and lastly, oh yes, sorry. And lastly, I'll just end sort of echoing both Han and Elena's points of urgency, or like not giving into this sense of urgency. I think that I've talked a lot to a lot of other Asian American folks about, you know, allowing us time to process our grief before we speak aloud, which is something that I have had a lot of trouble doing. But at the same time, I think also recognizing that these waves of violence, physical violence, can also negatively harm our allied communities, and also recognizing that for me personally, I don't need an urgent response from someone who's not in the Asian American community to ask me what I need right now, right? I think learning and educating oneself about anti-Asian rhetoric is a long process, and I don't need you to prove to me, or I don't think you need to prove to people on social media that you're an advocate in doing the work. Like, you can just do the work. And I think that's something that we all maybe would benefit from, because I think there's these additional stressors that we put on ourselves to try and convince everybody that we're doing the work or that we're doing okay, when it's okay that we're not fully there yet. So, thank you.
Thank you so much. Yeah, I really love this point that I think we kind of our more recent comments have mentioned in terms of the pace, right? And giving ourselves time. And I know a lot of people, a lot of scholars working and organizers working in this field have not had the time to process, right? Because we feel kind of compelled to speak about these issues. And so even processing grief is kind of something that is challenging in this moment. So thank you so much. I really appreciate all of you taking the time, all the speakers taking your time to speak, and the all of the audience for engaging so thoughtfully and taking the time to attend. If you have any questions, I think the Asia Center probably has the link up, and we can maybe offer some more information about some of the groups that we talked about today on there. But thank you so much, and I hope you all continue to think about these issues and also enjoy the rest of your semester, and given that probably many of you are in there. Okay, thank you. Bye.